sexual reproduction in animals. This process involves fertilization, which is the fusion of haploid gametes to form a zygote. So in animals, there are sex organs known as the gonads. In the male, there is the testes, and in the female, the ovary, responsible for the formation of the gametes. The male gamete, produced from the testes, is known as the spermatozoon, or simply the sperm, while the female gamete, produced by the ovary, is known as the ovum. The process of gamete formation in both the testes and the ovary is known as gametogenesis. So through gametogenesis, sperms are produced in the testes, while the ova are produced in the ovary. The male and female gamete fuse during fertilization to produce the diploid zygote. Remember, the ova and the sperm are haploid. So when they come together during fertilization, they form the diploid zygote. The zygote then undergoes growth through repeated the process of mitotic cell division to form the new animal. So from one cell, through repeated mitotic cell division, millions and upon billions are formed, which constitutes the body of the new animal. And that's how, in a nutshell, sexual reproduction takes place in animals. Now, fertilization process may occur internally or externally. In other words, there are two types of fertilization. There's one that occurs externally and the other one that takes place internally. Now we look at each of the two types and the type of animals where they take place, starting with external fertilization. In the external fertilization, the male and female gametes fuse outside the body. It occurs in animals such as fish and amphibians. For external fertilization to occur, a water environment is needed for the process. During this process, the male and female individuals of the same species come into close proximity and release their gametes into the surrounding water where fertilization takes place. So, for instance, in the fish, the male and the female come into close proximity. See, the female releases the ova, and the male at the same time also pours the sperms over the ova. So the sperms and the ova fuse in the water, and once the eggs become fertilized, then the embryo develops within each egg. Then hatching takes place and the young fish come out as new individuals and continue growing to mature size. So for external fertilization to be possible, the male and the female must be close together and they release their gametes at about the same time in order for the fertilization to take place. The other group of animals that carry out external fertilization are the amphibians, that include the frogs and the toads. In these amphibians, the male frog croaks to attract the female. See here, there's a male frog croaking, or toad croaking. Usually they do this while in water, because remember, they require the water environment for fertilization. So the male produces specific sounds that attracts the female of the same species. The male then mounts the female. So this is the male. And then beneath the male, there is a female. This takes place in water, where as the female releases her eggs, the male pours the sperms over them. So usually, as the male mounts the female, the male stimulates the female into releasing her eggs. And as the eggs are released, the male sheds the seminal fluid that contains the sperms over them. The sperms swim and enter the eggs to bring about fertilization. Now, in the frogs and the toads, the eggs are surrounded by a jelly substance that make the eggs look like this. They can kind of form of ribbons or strings of fertilized eggs or a mass of eggs that are held together. Now, the jelly plays the following roles. That is, advantages of the eggs being surrounded by the jelly are as follows. One, the jelly provides protection against predators as it is slippery and has a distasteful smell. So this jelly is distasteful to predators. Distasteful to predators, and in this way, the eggs are protected from consumption. Secondly, the jelly separates and spreads out the eggs, thus ensuring good aeration. Three, the jelly attaches the eggs to the water plants to stop them from being swept away by water currents. In other words, the jelly anchors the eggs so that they are not spread and carried away by the water currents. And four, the jelly makes the eggs buoyant, which is good for aeration. So the jelly makes the eggs float. And when they stay on the surface, they get good supply of oxygen for optimum growth rate of the embryo within. So that is the external fertilization that occurs in animals such as fish and amphibians. Now, the other type of fertilization is the internal fertilization. And in this, the male and the female gametes fuse inside the female's body. It occurs in animals such as mammals, birds, and in reptiles. So for internal fertilization to take place, the sperms must be introduced into the female's reproductive tract during copulation. So in these pictures here, we see the process of copulation taking place. The male introduces the sperms into the female reproductive tract during copulation. And once the sperms are inside the female's body, then fertilization occurs internally. Now, there are some distinct advantages of internal fertilization, and they include the following. One is that internal fertilization provides higher chances of gamete fusion. Thus, the smaller number of sperms are required, and because of this, less resources are used in gamete formation. Because it occurs inside the female body, where there are higher chances of the male and the female gamete fusing. So there is no need for a large number to increase the chances. So with a smaller number of gametes produced, resources are thus conserved and used for other processes within the body. So less resources are used in gamete formation where there is internal fertilization. The second advantage is that there are higher chances of the embryo survival. This is because since the fertilized egg is protected within the female body for some time as the embryo develops, there are higher chances of this embryo surviving, because by the time it comes out of the female's body, the embryo is at a relatively higher stage of development. Now, there are three categories of animals with internal fertilization based on how and where the embryo develops after fertilization. The first categories are the oviparous animals. These animals lay eggs containing the embryo with its food reserves and enclosed in a protective shell. So oviparous animals lay eggs that contain the embryo and its food reserves. The embryo therefore develops out of the body. Examples, birds, such as you can see, there's a hen incubating her eggs, and then a chick at maturity hatches, comes out of the egg. Another example are the reptiles, here represented by the crocodile. You can see the crocodile laying her eggs, usually in the sand by the banks of a river or a lake. Then after some time, the eggs hatch and the young crocodiles come out of the shells. So these oviparous animals lay eggs. So after fertilization, the egg forms, and within the egg there are food reserves, and the embryo together with the food reserves are enclosed in a protective shell that is usually made of calcareous material or can be leathery and made of protein material. The second category of animals are the viviparous animals. The viviparous animals. In these animals, the embryo is retained in the female's body within a specialized structure known as the uterus, where the embryo is nourished and protected as it grows and develops. These are the mammals. Mammals such as the antelope, the buffalo, retain the embryo within the female's body where it undergoes substantial growth and development, and then it is born. After it has undergone some level of growth and development, so by the time the young one is born, it is alive. So mammals give birth to live young ones at the end of the embryonic development. Now, this condition where the female animal gives birth to a live young one is known as viviparity. So viviparity, from the word viviparous. So mammals give birth to live young ones at the end of the embryonic development period. And the third category of animals are the ovoviviparous animals. The ovoviviparous animals. These animals produce eggs just like the oviparous, but instead of laying the eggs, they retain them within the female's body for protection. The eggs then hatch within the female's body, and the young ones are born live, just like in the case of viviparity. Hence the term ovoviviparous animals, because it's a combination of production of eggs and giving birth to live young ones. So this condition in which embryos develop inside the female's body, retained within the eggs, until they hatch is known as ovoviviparity. That is the condition in which the embryos develop inside the eggs retained within the mother's body until they hatch, is known as ovoviviparity. And it occurs mainly in reptiles, certain types of snakes, like the rattlesnake. See here the rattlesnake giving birth. Boa constrictor is a boa constrictor that has given birth to many young snakes. And also it takes place in the vipers, like in the puffada. See it giving birth to many young ones. What has happened is that these snakes produce the eggs but retain them inside their body for protection. Then these eggs hatch and the young ones are thus born. It also occurs, that is, ovoviviparity also occurs in certain types of chameleons.